Welcome to Collector's Lot. I'm Sarah Greene. On today's programme, a collection of glass from the 1920s and 30s by one of the most important makers in the country. A sculptor makes a lizard fountain, a collection of shawls, and tax discs. Now, the mere mention may make your heart sink, but for one man they spell pure joy. But first, Ken Snowden remembers times gone by.
How do you keep your memories safe? How do you stop them being like the socks in your sock drawer, a jumble at the best of times, but sometimes missing altogether? I said to Mother, "Mother, we ought to make some vignettes." She thought that was some kind of posh foreign pastry. No, I said, little tableaus like Wendy and Laurie's tea shop.
Ticket to the past, please.
That's 2 and 6 pence, please. Right, would you like to follow me?
Presumably a collection this big started with a single object, did it, Wendy?
Yes, it did. It started with a little 10 pence Oxo tin, and it just reminded me of my childhood. So I thought, well, it'd be nice to collect tins. So then I went from tins to packaging. And anything that was, you know, remotely connected with the 30s and the 40s, which was sort of a nice period for me. And it grew. And then I thought, well, it would be nice to do something with it. And then my husband moved here. And we looked around for somewhere to open up permanently with the tea rooms as well.
But it's not just packaging, is it? Because you've got a fantastic selection of old cameras here. Did you have an interest in photography at all?
Not particularly, no. I started to collect everything, which was ridiculous, but it's nice to have such a variety.
And do you remember using anything like that?
Oh, yes, yes. Yes, my dad had an old brownie box camera. Took numerous photographs with it.
And there's a very interesting kind of social scene here, the lady in the hairdressers under the rather frightening-looking hairdryer there. Presumably, again, that strikes a chord with you.
Yes, I don't go quite as far back as the hairdryer.
But certainly the hair.
Curlers and things, yes. They were purgatory, yes, if you happen to go to bed in them. And I always used to hope that when my mum put curlers in my head that we didn't have any lightning strike. I thought, it'll hit me.
What gives you the idea for the displays, then?
Well, mostly my husband set up the displays. He used to work in the co-op drapers when he was a teenager. So his favourite job was window dressing.
At the age of 15, it was time to leave school in the year 1953. And I got the apprentice draper's job in a thing called the Loch Kelly Co-op store, Fifeshire in Scotland. And I seemed to find myself being asked to do the displays more and more. So what you see here really is, I suppose, a bit of a copy of what I was asked to do in those days.
And of course all this was sold at the time, but people for some reason kept it. Why do you think that was?
I think part of the packaging was the attraction. You don't want to get rid of it. It just is different from anything else you might see. And you just think, well, I think I'll keep that. Because it's attached to a memory, more or less. We get parties of people in here from all over the place. And I love to just stand at the back and be invisible, because I hear them screech and scream. And one woman said, oh my goodness, and I said, what is it? She says, I used to stand in a biscuit tin in my granny's pantry to reach such and such, and it's just all come back to me. So nearly everything here has a memory for somebody, and it comes on a shock.
I met a woman on the stairs just now. She said her name was Irene, but I don't suppose it was. She said she had trouble with her memory from her school days. She found it over there.
What a place to unlock those reminiscences. James Powell and Son, also known as Whitefriars, is one of the most famous and was one of the longest surviving glass manufacturers in the country. And my first guest today, Brian Cargin, is an avid collector. Welcome to you, Brian.
Thank you very much.
Now, is this your entire collection that we see?
No, it's not. I've got some more at home.
Just a bit more?
Just a few pieces, yes.
I guess this is a tiny fraction. Now, we're concentrating on the glass of which era?
20s and 30s.
What was the sort of glass that Whitefriars produced, James Powell produced, up until that point?
Well, very fine, elegant glass of very high quality and very good design. Here's an example of some of it here.
What, these two pieces?
Yes, they're from about the 1880s.
Yes. I mean, there's almost something of the arts and craft movement about those pieces to me.
Very much so. There isn't very much arts and craft glass, but I think you could describe this as very much that way.
Was William Morris a fan, do you think?
I think he was. I know he sold some of their glass in his shop.
Yes. So what happened then later on during the 20s and 30s where suddenly you've got some quite revolutionary designs taking place, haven't you?
You have. They, under the Harry Powell influence, they kept this very thin, elegant line.
Yes.
And he died in about 1922, I think, and then the style changed quite dramatically then.
Tell us about this beautiful glass here.
That's one of his designs from about 1900.
I mean, it looks so ahead of its time. But one thing I do notice is that you've got this little rim at the bottom here around the neck of this glass, and you see it on some of the other pieces. Was that a signature, if you like?
They like using that. They called it rigory, and I think it's something left over from the Roman times.
Let's move forward, because here we've got some pieces from very different eras, haven't we? Tell me about the markings, how you can spot Whitefriars, James Powell glass.
It's very seldom marked. They sometimes had paper labels on them, but the only ones that are marked are the coronation goblets or commemorative pieces.
Can you just lift that so we can see the marking underneath? You just point that. And it actually does say Whitefriars. And so how can you tell if you've lost the paper label and there is no marking underneath the piece?
The quality and the colour is very significant. So I have difficulty with the colours because I'm colourblind.
And yet you love this work. So how do you tell? What are the clues for you? Let's take these pieces, for example, here. How can you tell what something actually looks like?
Well, the quality of the glass, the swirliness, the lack of too many bubbles, and the ring, if you give it a slight tap. It has a very nice ring.
Demonstrate that to us. Is this a good piece to try that out on, do you think?
It's probably quite good, yes.
Yes. Tell me how it works. So clear, isn't it? Don't let it finish, though. I'm a bit superstitious about that.
Yeah.
What are the different names to the markings?
This is a streaky. That's a streak as well, from the 1920s or 30s. And this is a streaky they did in the 1970s for a short period under Geoffrey Baxter.
Quite late on. Now, there are very different thicknesses to the glass. The designs, even though they have names, each piece, I would imagine, would turn out differently, wouldn't it?
All the streaky ones will turn out completely differently, yes, because
yes.
They just gather their colours up and then they're not really sure how they're going to end up.
But that's what's so attractive about it, isn't it? That you never quite know what you're going to get. And I mean, here we have pieces that almost look like ceramic. There's certainly some enamel feeling there. Am I right?
Yes, they've got enamel mixed in with the glass when they blow it.
Yes, and it's got a sort of opalescence about it too, and an opaque quality.
It's very opaque. This is called cloudy glass. The streak is not opaque at all, but the cloudy glass is.
Yes. When did they stop producing glass?
1980.
What's your favourite piece? Have you brought a favourite here?
There's so many, really. I like the early elegant ones of Harry Powell.
Yes,
I think.
Yes. Well, thank you very much for showing us the Powell glass of the 20s and 30s.
Okay, you're
thank
welcome.
You very much, Brian. Now, remember, if you have a collection you'd like us to know about, then get in touch at Collector's Lot, P.O. Box 17, Plimpton, Devon, PL7 5YG, or you can email us at lot@24.co.uk. Now, before your very eyes, sculptor Lucy Smith conjures up an elegant and exotic water feature.
I made my first fountain about 5 years ago when my father asked me to make him a fountain for his garden, actually, which is a beautiful, beautiful garden. Nature's a big inspiration, yeah. Yeah, I mean, sort of my whole childhood was sort of spent around in sort of nature and gardens and things. And I mean, they're lovely, lovely animals to sort of to work with, because they're very secretive and they've got lots of character. And I think they've got spirit as well. Welcome to my studio. This is where I make all my fountains and bowls and plaques. They're all displayed behind me and drying behind me. This is the prototype for a fountainhead, which is going to be moulded up. I just need to finish this lizard off. I need to put some more scales on it to make it look as liquid and fluid as possible. I need to make a mould so that I can make copies of this piece. And the legs form a severe undercut for any mould, so I'm going to have to cut them off and the head and make the body so it isn't an undercut. Okay, so I've cut the limbs off and the head, and all these pieces are now ready to make moulds of. The legs are going to be a two-piece mould each, and the head is actually going to be a three-piece mould. This one is going to be one mould. Okay, so here we have the finished mould. I'm just cleaning it off. It's now the negative of the lizard body and the back plaque. Is I'm going to start pressing clay into it to press mould it. So this is the piece press moulded. And now it's ready to come out, really. The plaster has allowed the clay to, or has forced the clay to shrink. Oh, okay. I'll lift the moulds up, they get very heavy. Now, this is I put this under to support the clay as it's lying flat, and I'm going to tip it out. Oh, there it is. Great. And now we're just going to take the head out of the mould. Okay, the next thing I have to do is I have to remodel this piece, taking away this kind of area here, which I built up to avoid the undercuts. And then I'm going to reattach the head. If you gently twist it, you can feel the clay starting to harden as the piece joins. I now need to make a hole into the mouth, because otherwise it wouldn't be a fountain. I've put that in the centre, sort of as near as possible to where the head is, so that the flow of water will mask the pipe. That is finished and ready to dry for 2 weeks. I'm going to put it up on the shelves and allow it to dry until it's bone dry, so that then I can fire it. Okay, so here's the biscuited piece. You biscuit it so that, A, so you've got a nice solid piece of clay to work with, but also so that it's porous enough for the glaze, which I'm going to apply now, to be applied. So when I finish glazing it, I will put it into the kiln at a temperature of 1240 degrees. Let's open it up. Yes, excellent. Okay, here's the finished piece. I'm very pleased with it. It's come out the kiln, and now it's ready to have the pipe put into the back and then put in the garden to work as a fountain.
Beautiful piece. After the break, Martin Beaumont's on the hunt for old tax discs and a must-have fashion essential for almost 100 years, the shawl. See you in 2 ticks.
Are you juggling too many credit bills every month? Isn't there a better, more affordable way to budget? Well, now there's a solution. A secured personal loan from First Plus. Running a busy home can be quite demanding. First those bills, then the credit and store cards, perhaps a car loan. Put all these together and your monthly commitments soon mount up. Alternatively, you could drastically cut your monthly outgoings with one monthly repayment to First Plus. You could even cut your monthly outgoings in half. So, whether you want to consolidate all your outstanding credit into one low monthly repayment, or you need a lump sum to bring your dreams to life, call First Plus now. If you're a homeowner, you can apply for a First Plus secured personal loan right now. The call is free, and you'll get a quick decision. Call First Plus now on 0800 052 6000.
Are you making the most of your computer? Would you like to design a special birthday card, get on top of your household accounts, or write a winning CV? You could with How to Do Just About Anything on a Computer. This amazing book from Reader's Digest will transform your PC into a powerful tool to make your life easier and more enjoyable. It'll show you how to surf the internet and send emails, how to check your bank balance, or how to chart your family tree. Written in clear, accessible language, it offers a step-by-step guide to everyday tasks, with over 1,500 illustrations to show you exactly what you'll see on your computer screen. So you can book your next holiday online, create your own menus for a celebration, or even set up a new business from home. Call 0808 100 2802 now, and we'll send you How to Do Just About Anything on a Computer for a 7-day home trial. If you decide to keep it, pay just £29.99. You'll also get this free CD-ROM containing dozens of exciting PC projects. Send no money now. Just call 0808 100 2802 to reserve your copy. Call now.
If you're a locksmith, get some security. If you're a chef, prepare yourself. If you're a researcher, do some research. If you're an actor, act now.
Stakeholder pensions from Norwich Union. Together we're stronger.
If you love your home, you won't want to leave it if stairs become a problem. Why not call Stanner now? We pride ourselves on providing a range of safe and reliable stair lifts, and you can be sure of getting a friendly service at all times. No wonder Stanner is the world's most popular stair lift, giving over 150,000 people so far the freedom to go on living in their own homes. Call 0800 715 400 now for a free brochure. That's 0800 715 400.
Welcome back. Coming up, Martin Beaumont finds out that tax discs mean an awful lot more than a quick MOT and a visit to the post office. But first, while the Pashmina has had a lot of press over the last couple of years, the humble shawl needs a bit of a PR overhaul. And here to do just that is specialist and collector Meg Andrews. Welcome to you, Meg. Thank you for bringing your collection. Where does the shawl come from and how far back does it go?
Shawls come from Kashmir. And they were originally worn by men, not women, in India and Kashmir. And the East India employees brought them back in about the 1780s for their loved ones, for their wives. And it started a trend, a fashion.
What's the earliest shawl that you've got with you?
This is the oldest one, which is about 1800, 1810. Not from Kashmir, but British. But what's very interesting about it, it has a very Kashmiri design on it.
So where would this have been woven?
I'm afraid I don't know, and no one would be able to tell you that. That's one of the frustrating things about shawls.
But also one of the mysterious, intriguing things
yes,
as well,
yes.
I would imagine. It is quite beautiful, so obviously, even in this country, we're trying to echo those Kashmiri influences. Really?
Yes.
And then it was adopted as an article of clothing for women.
Yes.
Where does the paisley design come from? Is that a really stupid question? Because does it come from Scotland? Because all around us I can see this typical shape, the sort of teardrop. What's the real name for that?
Yes, it's no, it doesn't come from paisley, but everyone associates it with that centre. It comes from Persia originally.
Right.
And gradually evolved over here.
Right.
And paisley managed to produce shawls much more cheaply than any other of the British centres. And so one tends to talk about a paisley shawl,
yes.
That's a generic term.
I mean, you can see the different, what's it called, that shape?
The bote shape.
The bote shape.
Yes, which actually means flower in Persian.
Yes.
Because originally the shape was a sprig of flowers with roots. And it gradually evolved into the pine shape.
Let's talk about how the shawl itself evolved then. Mm-hmm. How did the shape change and why did it change?
Well, they were particularly fashionable from the 1780s because women started to wear the little neoclassical empire line dresses.
And these little stoles and shawls looked very, well, they, partly they were warm, but they looked very pretty. And that's this particular shawl.
This one?
Yes.
Is the oblong. Now, what about the shape that we tend to associate with the shawl shape, where it's a square
worn
folded
as a
over as a triangle, and then tell me about this kind of shawl.
Well, gradually dresses became larger on the shoulders, puff sleeves, and the skirts started to get larger. Mm. And this is in about the 1820s, and you needed a slightly larger shawl to wear. And so this type would have looked very good, this being a block printed
not
shawl.
Woven anymore, we're talking printing.
No, you might buy a woven or you might buy a block printed, depending on the occasion and how much money you've got.
Now this is enormous, this shawl. Is this a shawl? You know, it looks so big. How many feet is this piece of fabric?
This is actually 12 foot long. And I'll show you how it was worn first. This is an 1860s shawl, which was worn with a crinoline frame.
Yes.
Because gradually during the 19th century, the skirts got larger and larger, and they needed a huge shawl to cover their skirts. And it would have been folded into a square, and then with this top flap folded over, and perhaps a brooch at the front. And you can imagine, over a large framed
that would
skirt,
be held out at the back.
It would have looked very
that
majestic.
That would have been worn during the daytime?
Yes.
What would be the evening equivalent to that?
The evening shawl might have been a silk gauze, a printed silk gauze such as this, which is, as you can see, very beautiful and diaphanous.
Yes.
And the other important thing to remember about shawls is that there was an etiquette to wearing them.
You had to wear it a certain
you
way.
You had to look elegant, and women's magazines gave instruction on how to drape a shawl.
Am I doing this correctly?
A little lower.
Thank you very much indeed, Meg. Thank you. Car collectibles are huge. Shiny grills, chrome bumpers and sparkling bodywork. But Martin Beaumont has some fascinating facts up his sleeve to prepare you for a whole new world of collecting.
Did you know there are 28.3 million taxed vehicles on the road? Did you know the DVLA estimate that 1.5 million vehicles do not have an up-to-date tax disc? Did you know that in 1998-99, £5.1 billion was collected in car tax? And did you know there's a man in Suffolk that collects tax discs? And he's got over 15,000 of them. So, Neil, when did you start collecting tax discs and why do you do it?
When my father gave me one from his car, I kept it aside, and then 6 months later he gave me another one, and I put the two together, and I asked him what they were and what they were for, and he explained it to me, and I thought it was quite interesting. And then I decided to go around to the block where I lived and asked all the neighbours, and I came home the first day with about 20-odd, which at the time I thought was marvellous.
I mean, most parents would give you presents and things, but your dad was giving you old tax discs.
That's right, nicer, yeah, he knew what I was like. I got them from forklift trucks, mobile cranes, electric milk floats, all different things like that. I think the most unusual vehicle I've ever got a tax disc off is from something that's called a Wright Fun Train, and that actually was a massive three-wheeled fiberglass elephant that was taking kids for a ride at a local steam fair many years ago.
Do you get excited if you get a tax disc from a very flash car, like a Jensen or something?
Some of them in the collection are from Jensen's, or Ferrari, or Lagonda. That's always nice.
I understand also you've got an amazing memory for detail of these things.
That's right, I've memorised most of them, yeah.
Could I test you?
Go ahead.
Started for 10, no conferring. This is your first one. XLP287X.
That's a showman's haulage vehicle. It's a Ford Cargo, and it's a 7.5-tonne rigid truck.
Correct. TJ3001.
That's a Rolls Royce.
TJW618F. And you can phone a friend.
No, that's a Guy. And the earlier discs, they say farmer's goods. And then it changed hands to a showman later on.
Correct. 5549MC.
That's a Royal Enfield motorcycle.
Where'd you get them from?
I get them from friends, family. I go to a lot of steam rallies and vintage car fairs, but most of them come from the vehicle salvage centres.
So
this is the truck recycling centre then?
Yes, it is.
The place where trucks go to die.
Yes, unfortunately.
So this is the place you look for tax discs, yeah?
Yeah, it's a great place to look.
Isn't it dangerous climbing all over these vehicles?
Well, not really, because the proprietor always lets me know which places are dangerous and which places are safe.
Yeah, well, let's go and see what we can find then.
Let's have a look.
Dig a few up.
That's right.
Ah, you got there before I did.
Yep.
What's this one, any good?
Well, let's have a look, shall we? That's great, look at those, all going back all those years there. That's really good. That's a good find. Brilliant.
What about up here?
Let's have a look. Great, Martin. There's a few out of here. I think my own sort of way that because these vehicles get crushed and scrapped, in my own way, I'm preserving them really. With these discs in my collection, they'll always live on in the collection long after the trucks have gone.
So that little bit of paper is a piece of motoring history.
That's right.
And I bet Neil has never ever been caught with an out-of-date tax disc. Well, that's it for today. Remember, if you'd like more information on any of the collections you've seen, look at page 331 of Portel or channel4.com, which will take you through to the Collector's Lot website. I hope you've enjoyed the programme. See you again next time. Bye-bye.
And next time will be tomorrow at 3 o'clock. Coming up here on 4, the daytime detectives piece together the identity of a diarist who moved in Victorian high society, revealing secrets of her famous connections next.